Chapter 1 of Sir Titus Salt, Baronet, His Life and Its Lessons, Fry, Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Sir Titus Salt, Baronet, His Life and Its Lessons by Robert Balgarnie. We begin with the dedication, preface, introduction, and Chapter 1. Dedication to the Dowager Lady Salt of Crow Nest. This memoir of him with whom her own life was united 47 years is respectfully dedicated as a humble offering of affection both to the living and the dead by the author. Preface. This work has been written during the summer season and amid the pressing duties that a large seaside congregation entails. We are fully aware of its many imperfections, but such as it is, we send it forth. It has been throughout a labor of love, which we have gladly performed, in memory of one whose long friendship has been to us both an honor and a privilege. Though the lack of material, especially in connection with his earlier years, has rendered our task more difficult than we anticipated, yet we have done our best. If the record of such a life shall furnish the reader with an example worthy of imitation, if it shall stimulate him to lofty purpose, above all, if it shall induce him to regulate his course by Christian principles and to seek those things which are above, the highest desires of the writer will be attained. Scarborough, November, 1877. Chapter 1. Introductory. Friend of the suffering, helper of the weak, poor words are all that now we can afford, unless where tears of deeper homage speak, or silent reverence hails, the worth supreme, which may thy life one good diffusing beam. A. W. Chapter 1. Introductory. Wherefore I praise the dead, which are already dead, more than the living, which are yet alive. Ecclesiastes. When the grave closed over the honored remains of Sir Titus Salt, and his name and virtues were on many lips, a wish was expressed that a biography of him should be written. From the various sketches that had appeared in the London and provincial press, as well as from local publications that had been widely circulated, the more remarkable facts of his history were already known. But it was naturally supposed that a public man like Sir Titus, whose name was a household word in the neighborhood where he lived, whose fame had spread far and wide, whose commercial and philanthropic enterprises were preeminent, must have many other incidents in his life which some biographer would bring to light and which the public would be eager to know. Who the biographer should be was a question the present writer would have answered by selecting an author well known to the public, but it had not once entered into his mind that to a hand so unskilled as his would be confided the work. The responsibility of the selection, therefore, rests not with himself, but with the publishers, who thought that a short memoir of Sir Titus Salt should be prepared which might be useful to place in the hands of young men. It is in compliance with their request that this memoir is written, and expressly with the object in view thus indicated, to stimulate young men at the outset of their career by such a rare example of sterling principle, of indomitable perseverance, of resolute will, of thoughtful and patient toil, that led up to fortune and honor. For as we shall afterwards see, it was not from any adventitious circumstance of birth or affluence, not from good luck or the patronage of others, that Sir Titus rose to greatness. No, the resources were within himself. The forces were innate, and a hand higher than his own developed and directed them. It was surely the consciousness of this that led him to inscribe on his coat of arms the words, Quid non deliovante? What not by the help of God? Would that every young man might adopt such a motto at the very beginning of his career, for it is but the substance of words in the old book, In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. The blessing of the Lord it maketh rich, and he addeth no sorrow with it. In perusing this memoir, it is possible the reader may be disappointed with the lack of striking incidents therein. For this the writer cannot be held accountable. Except for the things Sir Titus did, there is very little material for a biography to be found. Most biographies are made interesting by records of conversations and extracts from letters and speeches, but in this case such materials are scanty. His words were always few, often painfully few. His power of conversation was so small that among strangers he often sat as the silent man. This arose not from lack of sympathy with the subject or of thought in connection with it, but from a constitutional reserve and nervousness which he could not help. It was only in the quiet of his home and in the presence of intimate friends that his views and feelings found utterance. As for his letters, they were also few and brief, and except on rare occasions were written by another hand. Not that his diction and penmanship were in any way defective. On the contrary, they were of a superior kind, terse, pointed, and legible. But he had no liking for the pen. It seemed too small an instrument for his large and practical mind to express itself by. His speeches delivered on two or three public occasions are preserved and will be reproduced in these pages, but they only half conceal and half reveal the soul of the speaker. His library was large and well selected, but his knowledge of books was limited, and the range of his reading confined to religious publications and the daily press. It will be evident, therefore, that the usual materials for a biography are in this case unobtainable. His deeds alone are his memoranda. Other men live in the books they wrote or the words they spake, but he lives alone in what he did. And just as books have to be studied to know the mind of the author, so his deeds have to be studied likewise to know the principles and motives that gave them birth. Like a strong oak, he silently grew into the large space he filled in the eye of the world, and was apparently unconscious of the greatness that gathered around his name. Perhaps when he lived, those who were nearest saw not that greatness, but now that the oak is laid low and the vacant space is left, and the great cable roots that moored him to the soil are bare, not till now are his girth and proportions known. What then, it may be asked, are the available sources from which the materials of this memoir are to be drawn? In the first place, we hereby acknowledge our obligations to the writers of various sketches in journals and newspapers, also to the interesting little work entitled Saltaire and Its Founder. These sketches, though necessarily fragmentary, have suggested the lines on which this biography is constructed and given directions to our own researches. We have corresponded and conversed with persons who were the contemporaries of his commercial life, who were associated with him in municipal and parliamentary affairs, who were his counselors and almoners in his philanthropic and religious projects. We have personally visited the scenes of his early days, both at Morley and Wakefield, and have gleaned from the failing memories of old people the only incidents they can recall. But chiefly have we drawn from our own personal knowledge of the late baronet, which an intimate and unbroken friendship of many years supplies. These are the materials which we attempt to weave into the fabric of a memoir. There may be little skill displayed in preparing the loom or arranging the threads, but the hand of affection guides the shuttle. End of chapter 1.
Chapter 2 of Sir Titus Salt, Baronet, His Life and Its Lessons. Sir Titus Salt, Baronet, His Life and Its Lessons, by Robert Balgarnie. Chapter 2. Go up and watch the newborn rill, just trickling from its mossy bed, streaking the heath-clad hill with a bright emerald thread. Canst thou her bold career foretell? What rocks she shall o'erleap or rend? How far in ocean's swell her freshening billows send? the ancestors of Titus Salt, whose title may be dropped for the present, came originally from Staffordshire. But this information is derived from tradition, not from authentic documents. The family of Salt still holds an honorable position in that county. How it came to migrate northward, we do not know. It has left a branch in Derbyshire, where it is also held in honor. But it is at Sheffield where this branch takes root in Yorkshire, and authentic information is obtained. It appears from old deeds that Titus Salt of Sheffield Whitesmith in 1763 married one Sarah Taylor, a widow, by whom he became entitled to some freehold property, described as in a certain place near the new church in Sheffield, commonly called Cherry Square. In 1755 there is a conveyance of property from the Reverend Christopher Alderson of Aston to Titus Salt, then described as of Hunslet Moor in the parish of Leeds, Whitesmith. In 1802 occurs his will, in which he is described as of Hunslet Moor, iron founder. He devised his Hunslet property to his son Titus Salt, and his Sheffield property to his son Daniel Salt. This Daniel Salt is described in a deed of 1811 as of Morley in the parish of Batley, Yeoman. When Titus and Sarah Salt removed from Sheffield to Leeds is not recorded, but Hunslet was undoubtedly the place of their abode. There the iron-founding business was carried on, not, we fear, with uninterrupted success, for at one time it failed, and Titus Salt then lost a large portion of his property. There, too, they died, the husband in 1804, the wife in 1802. Both were well stricken in years, and are buried in Hunslet churchyard. These were the grandparents of the late baronet. We remember once passing with him through that neighborhood, when he pointed to a certain locality and said, "My grandfather lived there." Mr. Daniel Salt succeeded to his father's iron-founding business, which he carried on for a few years. On the 5th July, 1802, he married Grace Smithies of the old manor house, Morley. Her father, Isaac Smithies, had recently died, leaving no one to succeed him in his business of dry salter. In consequence of this, Daniel Salt came to reside, after his marriage, at the old manor house, and for a while carried on both his own business at Hunslet and that of his late father-in-law at Morley. This arrangement, however, was of short duration. The Leeds business was given up, and he afterwards was known at Morley as Daniel Salt, White Cloth Merchant and Dry Salter. These were the parents of the late baronet, from whom he inherited those mental and physical qualities that made him what he became. Mr. Daniel Salt, his father, was a plain, blunt Yorkshireman, both in manner and speech. He was tall in size, strong in bone and muscle, with an impediment in his utterance. He is still remembered for his energy and industry in business, and for many quaint and original sayings that fell from his lips. Mrs. Daniel Salt was a woman of delicate constitution, retiring in her disposition, sweet and gentle in her ways, sometimes subject to mental depression, an earnest Christian, and a staunch nonconformist. Their portraits, taken in later years, now hang in the dining room at Crow Nest. Such were some of the characteristics of the parents, and which, with a few modifications, were reproduced in their son Titus, who was born at the old manor house on the 20th September, 1803, and, according to the record in the family Bible, at 4 o'clock in the morning. The hour of his birth may be forgotten, but not the day. During his life, many public celebrations of the day were held, but now, when he is gone, it will be celebrated as the Founder's Day, in several institutions that his benevolence enriched. Let us now visit Morley, the place of his birth and the scene of his childhood. Morley has an interesting history of its own, going back to Saxon, if not Roman, periods. At the time Titus Salt was born, it was a village of 2,100 inhabitants. At the time we write, it has grown into a town with nearly 13,000 people. It is situated in the parish of Batley, from which it is distant 3 miles, about 4 miles from Leeds, 5 from Dewsbury, and 7 from Bradford and Wakefield. It probably took its name from the words moor and lay, which together mean literally moorfields, and would describe the physical aspect of the district when it was named. The highest point in the neighborhood is the site where the church of St. Mary in the Wood stood for centuries, around which many generations of the inhabitants are buried, and where the new Congregational Church now stands. The view from this position, minus the sea, reminds one of Burial Hill at Plymouth, Massachusetts, the spot where the Pilgrim Fathers sleep, and in sight of Plymouth Rock, where they landed. From this commanding position at Morley, the eye takes in the entire village or town nestling around it, with its straggling streets, commodious places of worship, busy manufactories, and old mansions surrounded by ancient trees where colonies of rooks long have settled. There are several coal mines and stone quarries in the neighborhood, which are a source of considerable wealth. But this is the Morley of today. At the time we refer to, there were only 4 places of worship in it. Now there are 14. There was only 1 mill for the manufacture of cloth. Each house had a manufactory of its own, where the sound of the weaver's shuttle was constantly heard. But it is the moral and religious aspects of the place at the beginning of this century in which we are most interested. As the vintage of a district takes its character from the soil that produces it, so the surroundings of one's birthplace often color and give character to the whole life. It was so with Titus Salt at Morley. He there received those moral and religious impressions which remained with him through life. The people of Morley had much of the old Puritan spirit among them. The Sabbath was strictly observed. Family worship was common in many a home. The Bible and Bunyan's Pilgrim's Progress were the books most frequently read. Good Friday was not in their calendar, and the many fast days which human authority originated, they did not recognize, nor need we wonder at this. Apart from the Puritan memories that clustered round the place, there was no established church in it till 1830, so that nonconformity then occupied the unique position of having no national church in the town. Was not the church of St. Mary in the Wood connected with the Church of England? It originally belonged to the Roman Catholics and remained in their hands till the Reformation in 1534. Since then, it has been alternately in the hands of Episcopalians, Presbyterians, and Independents. It has had different names in its time, St. Mary and St. Nicholas being 2 of them. In later years, it was known as Morley Old Chapel, and occupied by the Independents till 1873, when the structure became unsafe and was pulled down. It must have been a source of bitter regret to the inhabitants when this ancient historical edifice vanished from their sight. What hallowed associations were connected therewith? Here, many of the ejected ministers of 1662 sought refuge when silenced by the Act of Uniformity. In the chapel yard, their tombstones still stand, under which their precious dust is hidden till Christ shall bid it rise. John Wesley often visited Morley and preached the gospel to the people. By these visits of this eminent man, a spirit of religious earnestness was awakened, which continues until now. Such is a brief survey of Morley and its people when Titus Salt was born. Let us enter the old manor house and look at the place where he first saw the light. It is well designated old, for it was built about 300 years ago, and was evidently not built to sell, but to last. The walls are in some places 3 feet thick. The roof is low and covered with slabs instead of slates. In front, the ivy throws its green mantle over the old walls. Behind, a contemporary pear tree stands, still bringing forth fruit in its season. If a manor was attached to the house in olden times, it is not so now, for it is surrounded by dwelling houses and warehouses. In Daniel Salt's time, there were 2 or 3 fields of pasture connected with the house, which belonged to the Earl of Dartmouth, by whom it was sold to Dr. Ellis, and is now occupied by a medical practitioner. But the old manor house has been subject to various changes, both within and without, since Titus Salt lived in it. When he afterwards paid a visit to it with his children, he could hardly identify the old place. The front entrance had been removed to the south end. Old windows had been built up and new ones made. The rooms on the ground floor, which were originally about 6 feet high, had been sunk a couple of feet and were now entered by steps downwards. That part of the premises where his father's dry-salting stores were kept was transformed into a drawing-room. The kitchen with its stone flags, the ceiling with its bare wooden beams, where the oat-cakes were suspended to harden and the hams to dry, the wide stone staircase leading to the floor above, many of these remained much the same, but all other marks of identity were effaced. No, not all. One object alone was left which vividly recalled the period of boyhood, and that was the pear tree at the back of the house. "Ah," said he, "I remember that tree well, for I often climbed it to gather its fruit." It is in this old-fashioned house we are introduced to Titus Salt. He was the first of a large family, consisting of 3 sons and 4 daughters, all of whom are gone, save one. It is not a little singular that he was twice baptized, the first time on the 9th November, 1803, by the Reverend Thomas Clough of Morley Old New Chapel, the second time on the 27th February, 1805, at Batley Church by the Reverend J. Sedgwick. The reason for this double baptism was not because there was any doubt about the validity of the first, but probably for the sake of an entry in the parish register, which was then the only legal record of births, deaths, and marriages. To some readers, it may thus appear doubtful whether Titus Salt was a child of nonconformity or of the established church. His parents at this time were connected with the old new chapel above referred to. This congregation was an offshoot from the old chapel, hence the double name given it. The separation took place on doctrinal grounds, many of the hearers being dissatisfied with their minister's views, which had a strong flavor of Socinianism. They met in a licensed dwelling-house at first, until a site for a chapel was obtained from the Earl of Dartmouth, which was erected in 1765. It was the chapel of which the Reverend T. Clough was the pastor in 1804, but owing to a notice from Lord Dartmouth to quit the premises, a new one was erected in 1835, called Rehoboth Chapel, of which the Reverend J.P. James is the present pastor. We can, therefore, satisfactorily answer the question as to whether Titus Salt belonged to nonconformity or the establishment. In a certain sense, he belonged to both, legally to the latter, hereditarily, and afterwards conscientiously to the former. To those who have been taught to lay much stress on the rite of baptism, as affecting the moral nature and influencing the future destiny of the recipient, we can only say, be Sir Titus Salt's first baptism valid or invalid, he at least received the rite in two communions, and in this respect he differed from many. The other children born at Old Manor House were Sarah, Hannah, and Isaac Smithies. The two last named died in infancy and were buried at the old new chapel, Morley. The state of Mrs. Salt's health being so delicate, she was unable to nurse the children born to her. But a valuable substitute was found in Mrs. Ellis, who tended them as if they were her own during their infancy. Happily, Titus did not inherit the feeble constitution of his mother, but the strong and vigorous constitution of his father. As soon as he was able to run alone, he mingled with the children of the village. A cousin, still living, who was his playmate, says, "He was a bright boy for his years, full of fun when with those whom he knew well, but shy with strangers." This testimony is true, for the same characteristic was manifested in his riper years. Another playmate, still living, remembers that Titus had a wooden horse which his father bought him. In possession of such a toy, he was an object of envy to the other children around him. Seated upon it, he spent many an hour riding up and down the flagstones. But he seldom enjoyed his pastime alone, as his playmates were permitted to share it. Amongst them was Joe Ellis, who says, "I was the one who took turns with him." When Titus arrived at the usual age, he was sent to a dame's school in Morley, kept by Mrs. Nichols, under whose care he was taught to read. It must have been this school he once referred to in after years. Happening one day to meet a gentleman from Morley in a railway carriage, the conversation turned on Morley, which recalled old memories. As soon as the gentleman mentioned his name, he exclaimed, "I remember your mother. We went to school together." Of course, this dame's school was only preparatory to another. But whether it was the Morley Town School, kept by Mr. Trenham, is uncertain. If so, he came under the influence of a man held in high esteem in the village. Be that as it may, there is credible evidence that when 8 or 9 years old, he went to a school at Batley, then under the care of the Reverend J. Sedgwick, curate of the parish church. It was a long distance for a boy of his years to walk every day. How few boys nowadays would do it! 6 miles to school and back! Yet he was only one of a group to whom the journey was a healthy and bracing exercise. They started each morning at 8:30 and reached Batley in time for school at 9:30. A happy group of boys that was, and cheerily their voices rang as they passed along Scotchman Lane together. This lane was noted for the number of gypsies who encamped there, and often succeeded in purloining property from the neighboring villages. But these schoolboys kept each other's courage up by keeping together. They were accustomed to meet at a rendezvous in the lane. Those who were in time wrote their names on a piece of slate, which was deposited in a well-known hole in the wall, for the perusal and encouragement of the boys who were late. The curriculum at Batley's school was both classical and commercial, but Titus's attention was confined to the ordinary branches of instruction. As for dinner, he carried it with him. It consisted of oat cake and milk fresh from the cow. To this latter circumstance he once incidentally alluded a few years before his death. Some children happened to be visiting at Crow Nest. On their return from the dairy, where they had tried their hand at milking the cows, great was their amusement and surprise when their kind-hearted host told them that in his schoolboy days he had to go in the dark mornings to draw his own supply of milk for the day before setting out for school. But what was Titus Salt's education at home? It need not be told that the character and habits generally take the permanent shape and form that the plastic hand of a parent gives them. To his father he was indebted for many wise counsels and for instructions in practical mechanics with which his former occupation made him familiar. But his higher home education was imparted by his mother. It was from her he acquired that respect for religion, that regard for the Sabbath, that reverence on entering the house of God, that personal attachment to Christian ministers and their work, which were retained as long as he lived. It was by her alone his youthful lips were taught to pray, to read the Bible both morning and evening, and to make it the man of his counsel in the house of his pilgrimage. Among many relics of the deceased baronet at Crow Nest, not the least precious is the well-worn pocket Bible, the gift of the parent to the son, with the following inscription: To Titus Salt, may this blessed volume ever lie close to thy heart and near thine eye, till life's last hour thy soul engage, and be thy chosen heritage. It is worthy of notice that to each of his own children he presented a pocket Bible in which was written with his own hand the above lines. May the prayer therein expressed be realized. End of chapter 2. Chapter 3 of Sir Titus Salt, Baronet, His Life and Its Lessons. Sir Titus Salt, Baronet, His Life and Its Lessons, by Robert Balgarnie. Chapter 3. Let us know our indiscretion sometimes serves us well, when our deep plots do pall, and that should teach us there's a divinity that shapes our ends, rough-hew them how we will. Shakespeare. Mr. Daniel Salt removed from Morley about the year 1813. Titus was then nearly 10 years of age. To the son, this removal was only a pleasant episode in a boy's history, but it was not so to the parents. To them it was a severe trial indeed, for were they not leaving the old manor house where their wedded life began and their children had been born? And then, in the old new chapel burying ground, there were those little graves in which their hearts were left. The cause of this removal from Morley is not precisely known. It might be that Mr. Daniel Salt preferred the country life of a farmer to that of a dry salter, or that his present occupation was unremunerative, and the cultivation of a farm might possibly increase his resources. In this latter expectation, however, he was certainly disappointed. No doubt at that time farming was a profitable occupation to many. The wars with Napoleon Bonaparte then raged, during which prices were high and fortunes among large farmers were rapidly made. But when peace was proclaimed, prices went down. It was, therefore, at a time of farming prosperity that Mr. Daniel Salt removed from Morley and entered upon the farm of Crofton. Crofton is an old-fashioned village, situated about 3 miles from Wakefield, on the Doncaster Road, then belonging to Sir Henry W. Wilson, Baronet. The farm consisted of about 100 acres of arable land, with a comfortable dwelling-house and farm offices contiguous. The parish church stands in the immediate neighborhood, of which the Reverend Edward Hill was vicar for many years, and from which he was ejected by the Act of Uniformity for conscience' sake. The death of this saintly man was a very affecting one. He had attained a prolonged age and was confined to his room. In the same chamber was his wife, who had been bedridden for 2 years and was near her end. Mr. Hill left his bed with difficulty to take leave of her, and as he kissed her for the last time, he said, "Ah, my dear wife, thou hast followed me for 40 years. Tarry a little, and let me go before thee." He was with some difficulty carried back to his couch, and immediately expired, his wife dying within 2 hours. They were buried at Halifax in the same grave. Titus Salt was thus brought again into a locality around which the memories of good men still lingered, and which at his time of life were likely to leave a deep and lasting impression upon his heart. Crofton was also celebrated for a young ladies' boarding school kept by Miss Magnall, who was then widely known not only for the efficiency of her training, but for the popular book on education entitled Magnall's Questions. In the homestead of Crofton, other children were born. The nearest congregational place of worship to Crofton was Salem Chapel, Wakefield, of which the Reverend B. Rayson was the minister, a man highly esteemed both for his learning and piety. With Mr. Rayson's congregation and ministry, Mr. and Mrs. Salt were connected, but as the distance was great and the health of the latter feeble, she was unable to attend divine service regularly. Yet the loss of public worship was made up to her by services conducted in her own house. For this, a license had to be obtained from the civil authorities to escape the penalties then imposed on those who dissented from the forms of the established church. The old manor house, Morley, had been licensed for a similar purpose. The following copy of an old form of license is given in Smith's History of Morley. A congregation or assembly of Protestant subjects dissenting from the Church of England do hold their meetings for religious worship on the Lord's Days in Topliff Hall, Woodkirk, and they hold other occasional meetings at J. Pickering's house at Tingley. Joe Pickering, Thomas Atkinson. It was under a license similar to the above that religious services were occasionally conducted in the farmhouse at Crofton, without the use of the Book of Common Prayer. Many hallowed gatherings took place there. The people in the village were free to come, and some who hungered for the bread of life felt it good to be here. The Reverend Mr. Bruce of Zion Chapel, Wakefield, frequently officiated on these occasions. By him and other good men, the lamp of divine truth was kept alive in this and neighboring places, which, but for such ministrations, had well nigh gone out. Such were the religious surroundings of Titus Salt at Crofton between 1814 and 1818. And those who, in after years, were struck with the simplicity of his faith, his preference for inornate worship, his attachment to nonconformity, will now see where his principles were planted and how they were nurtured. But his secular education had yet to be acquired. He had now arrived at the age of 11, and was sent by his father to the day school connected with Salem Chapel, Wakefield. The Reverend B. Rayson, along with the duties of his pastorate, uniting those of a schoolmaster. The school was held in a building adjoining the chapel in George Street, now used as a printing office. In a letter from a gentleman still living who was at school with Titus, the following extract is given. Mr. Rayson gave up the school at Christmas, 1815, from which time it was conducted by Mr. Enoch Harrison, who had for several years been Mr. Rayson's principal assistant, and with whom young Salt remained some time. His father's residence being upwards of 3 miles from the school, Titus generally rode on a donkey, which was left until the afternoon at the Nag's Head, a small inn near to the school, bringing with him in a little basket his dinner. In person he was tall and proportionately stout, and of somewhat heavy appearance. His dress was usually that of a country farmer's son, viz., a cloth or fustian coat, corduroy breeches with long gaiters, or, as they were generally called, spats or leggings, buttoned up the side, with strong boots laced in front. He was generally of a thoughtful, studious turn of mind, rarely mixing with his schoolfellows in their sports and play, and rather looked upon by them as the quiet, dull boy of the school. His words were generally so few that I cannot call to mind any particular thing that he either said or did. The school was a mixed school for both sexes, the boys occupying the ground floor and the girls the room above, and it was considered the best private day school in the town. At this school, his sister Sarah also attended. They rode on a donkey together, and it was probably more for her benefit than his that its help was required. For at Morley, even when he was younger, and the distance much the same, the journey to and from school was performed on foot. But the teacher to whom Titus Salt was most indebted for his education was the Mr. Enoch Harrison above referred to, and this memoir of the pupil would be incomplete were it not to contain a brief sketch of one who did much to equip him for his future career. From Mr. Harrison's own lips we gathered the particulars of Titus's school life at Wakefield. When we saw the former, he was in declining health, yet clear in intellect and retentive in memory. But alas, since that interview which we had hoped to renew, he has passed away at the ripe age of 81 years. From the obituary which appeared after his decease, the following extract is taken. It would be no flight of imagination to say that this announcement is calculated to arrest the attention and awaken the sympathies of men and women scattered throughout the entire kingdom, and of others also, who long ago left the town to seek and find their fortunes in distant lands. It would, in fact, be difficult to place any limit to the number of those who owed, in great part, their chief and lasting possessions to an early association with Mr. Harrison. Some of our most distinguished townsmen of past and present times have been proud to tell that, when boys, they attended his school, and to that circumstance attribute hardly less than to their own personal virtues, their ability to rise in the world of business, politics, or religion, and their safeguard from the manifold influences which, yielded to, have made wrecks of others. Mr. Harrison made the training of youth his one great life work. It was the sphere from which he never departed. All the resources of a capacious mind, a retentive memory, and a calm judgment were devoted to the duties of the desk and the classroom, and were never suffered to be dissipated by any foreign considerations. The result was what it could only be, certain and ample success. His teaching was eminently substantial. His pupils were grounded in the several branches of learning to which their attention was directed, and all that was undertaken was thoroughly done and severely tested. Among those who passed through Mr. Harrison's school, we may mention the late Sir Titus Salt, Baronet. Wakefield Express, of 26th May, 1877. Such is the merited tribute paid to this remarkable schoolmaster, under whose care Titus Salt spent 4 years of his life at Wakefield. The instruction imparted was what was recognized as a plain commercial education, including history, geography, and drawing. If any of the pupils wished to study the classics, they were permitted to attend the grammar school, of which Dr. Naylor and Dr. Sissons were the masters. Mr. Harrison had a vivid remembrance of Titus Salt, of whose career he was justly proud, and whom he occasionally visited, both at Methley and Crow Nest in after years. It may also be said that the pupil was proud of his teacher, of whom he often spoke with respect, and sometimes exhibited to his friends those specimens of drawing and penmanship which, under this tutor's instruction, he had as a boy prepared. When Saltaire was opened in 1853, Mr. Harrison was among the guests invited to the banquet. But it may be asked, what was Mr. Harrison's opinion of his pupil? "He was," says he, "never a bright pupil. He was very steady, very attentive, especially to any particular study into which he put his heart. Drawing was his chief delight. He was a fine, pure boy, stout and tall for his age, with a remarkably intelligent eye. So much did his eye impress me that I have often, when alone, drawn it from memory, simply for my own gratification. I have sketches of him somewhere among my papers, with crimped frill round his neck, just as he appeared then, but, though naturally very quiet, he was sometimes given to random tricks." From the foregoing particulars, we can form some idea of Titus Salt at the age of 15. It is a well-known saying, "The child is father of the man," which in this case was abundantly verified, for the traits of character observable in his youth were not less conspicuous in his manhood. A very steady boy he was, and the germs of a great future were hidden in him. Steadily he jogs along the Doncaster Road every day to school on his donkey, with his sister behind on the pillion. We may be sure he was always in time, for punctuality was the rule of his life. What though he might be regarded as the dull boy of the school? Thus it was with Isaac Newton and Thomas Chalmers in their schoolboy days. Of the former, it is said that when at the grammar school of Grantham, he was always at the bottom of the class until he received a kick from another boy, whom he punished by getting above him. There were latent powers in the mind of young Titus that some day would be evoked, but he gave no sign of precocity or genius, such as mark the early life of some distinguished men. It was not at a leap that he was to outstrip other men, but by hard work and resolute perseverance. Is not this an encouragement to young men who hesitate to start in the race for wealth and honor among so many brilliant competitors? Know this from Titus Salt's character and career, that the race is not always to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, but that nothing is lost to well-directed and steady effort. Nothing is to be obtained without it. Note also that he was successful in those studies into which he put his heart. Thus it was with him in after life. It was by concentrating his mind and heart on one object that he excelled other men, and made for himself a name amongst them. One thing he did at a time, and because of this he did it well. Were his words always few? It was not by these he was to become great. Of mere talkers the world has always enough. Words are breath, but thoughts have life that endures. Was his attire plain and neat in boyhood? He had no affectation of dress in manhood. He wore nothing for mere show, and what suited his taste once was not superseded by something more attractive afterwards. Was he a pure boy at 15, in speech, in feeling, and in sentiment? Those who knew him best in after years can testify that anything in the way of untruthfulness, indelicacy, or dishonorableness, his soul abhorred. As for the remarkably intelligent eye that the schoolmaster was struck with in his pupil, it was not less so in manhood and old age. It was an eye large, clear, and searching, which, when calm, beamed benevolence, but when troubled, was equally capable of inflicting its ire on those who excited it. Titus Salt was now 17 years of age, and the question must be settled: what is he to be? He had no fortune to fall back upon, and if one was to be acquired, it must be by his own efforts. His father's circumstances, though not straitened, were not affluent. Indeed, the farm at Crofton did not pay, but brought loss to the tenant. An old acquaintance, still living at the age of 92, remembers Mr. Salt complaining of the badness of the times since the close of the war. "Yes," he said in his own peculiar way, "a man might have bread and milk to breakfast and supper, but that is not a living." While, therefore, it was evident that his son Titus must do something for his livelihood, it was not so easy to decide what. Had he no predilection of his own? Yes, it appears he had for some time cherished the purpose of being a doctor, in which case his education was only now at an incipient stage, and a considerable outlay of money must yet be incurred. One cannot help speculating as to what position Titus Salt would have occupied in the medical profession had his first intentions been carried out. His keen insight, calm judgment, and decision of character were qualifications most likely to ensure success in such a profession. Indeed, whatever occupation in life he had chosen and put his heart into would have led to distinction. But the question so important both to father and son was to be taken out of their hands. The lot is cast into the lap, but the whole disposing thereof is of the Lord. An accident, apparently trifling, determined his future course. One day he happened to be cutting a piece of wood with a sharp knife, which slipped and inflicted a deep wound in his hand. Blood flowed profusely, the sight of which made him faint. His father, coming in at the time, exclaimed, "Titus, my lad, thou wilt never be a doctor." In this opinion the son acquiesced, and henceforth the idea of entering the medical profession was abandoned.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.